The artwork for Anime Podcasters is provided by GoProkyo. Please go follow him at GoProkyo. Just a warning for everyone before you listen to this podcast, we're going to be talking about Future Diary, and it has some very explicit and intense themes, some sexual themes we're going to be talking about. If you are sensitive to those kind of topics, please do not watch this video. This is going to be your only warning. If you are not sensitive, please enjoy the show. Thanks, guys. Hi, guys, and welcome to a brand new episode of Anime Podcasters. JaianMusic is here. Is Yuki here? I can confirm with that noise that it's the brand new episode of Anime Podcasters, and we got an awesome topic. Yuki, what are we talking about today? Like, this is going to be so amazing.
First, I want to say that this is the first podcast that we have recorded in 2017.
Yeah, Happy New Year, guys. Happy New Year. Like, it's kind of late New Year by now, but, like, you know, Happy New Year. So congrats on making it to 2017.
Damn, Diane, I haven't seen you in a year.
I know, it's been forever. You've grown up so much.
We're going to be talking about Future Diary today, guys.
I am so excited about this episode. We're talking about Future Diary, this absolutely epic anime. I mean, you love this anime as much as the next one, right, Yuki? Or even more?
I'm a fan. Like, I really like the concept of there being a survival game.
Yes.
That's pretty cool.
Absolutely. I remember when my friend suggested it to me. The first time I heard about it, I was like, that sounds really, like, just confusing. But then
again, the plot itself is very confusing.
It is. But once I started watching it, I was sold, and I went through every single episode, and I loved it. Let's get it kicked off. Yuki, how did you find out about Future Diary? What was your first impressions? And what was your thoughts on the series overall as you were watching it?
Ah, man, that's actually pretty tough, because it's been so long that I can't even remember what got me into Future Diary in the first place. The first time I got interested in it was way back when it was just known as Mirai Nikki, like when it was back as an anime with only Japanese dub.
Right.
And with subtitles. When was it? Like, the one memory I have when I was, like, fairly new to Future Diary was when Yuno and Yuki has to go against Tsubaki, who was another diary holder.
Right.
Like, that, I think that was the episode that made a really big impression on me for someone who was fairly new to Future Diary. So when I saw it, I was just like, what is this? What is going on? Ever since that, I was just like, and then I then decided to just continue on, just like learning about the characters, and even got confused about the whole two Yuno thing.
Oh, that was confusing. Yeah.
Yeah, and then but now, because of clips, I understand why, and I was actually very happy with the whole concept, because that was like introducing me to the yandere-ness. Back then, I didn't really know much about yanderes until that moment.
Right. For those people who don't know what yandere is, really quickly, what's a yandere?
Yandere is basically, like, it's kind of like a contrast, or like very different from the term tsundere. A yandere is basically when it's like a term for someone who is obsessively and unhealthily in love with a person to a point where, and acts very sweet and kind to them, acting very innocent, until like to a point where they would even consider killing someone for them.
Okay, so for those who now know that, if you have a yandere in your life, consult someone, call for help. I think that's the best call right there. Call for help.
unless you're Yuki that stays with them, despite all that, despite the whole murdering shtick.
Yeah, despite the murders and still staying with them. I mean, at least he's loyal, right?
He had no choice before, but now he's doing it willingly.
Right. For me, when I, my friend introduced me to Future Diary. He told me, I actually remember we were out camping in this at a cottage with a bunch of friends, and
that is very interesting.
Yeah, I know.
January was there, man.
Oh my god. Yuki, you just broke the podcast.
Apparently now I'm a savage.
Oh, you I've always been a savage. Get like the, let's just make that clear, okay? From day one. So yeah, I was out camping with some friends, and my buddy said, "Oh, I just finished this anime. It's so epic. It's so good. You really need to watch it." And he's got really good judgment in anime, and he's like kind of the go-to person I ask for like suggestions once I finish a series. And so I watched the first episode of Future Diary with him, and obviously the concept I got super interested right away, and how there was this game of 12 different individuals, and each had a Future Diary, which was a cell phone, and how it predicts the future and everything, and how they kill off that first cell phone user in the at the top of the building in the very first episode with Yuno there and everything. I mean, it was just a great opening episode, and also I really like the opening track. The opening for Mirai Nikki is absolutely amazing.
Are you talking about the
Yes.
Like, sorry, I'm sorry, guys. I don't know, like, even the beginning of how that, like, of the lyrics of that freaking bit. I am so sorry.
So good. But no, you sung it well. That's exactly what it sounds like.
Yep.
Now I can take that vocal part and remix. No, I'm kidding.
Oh god.
So yeah, and I really enjoyed that anime, and I got home. I watched a few episodes. I put it down for a while because I was busy, and then I picked it back. And I was busy, I was like, "Oh, I gotta finish this anime. I really want to watch it." But I was like, "No, Jaian, like, do your work first." And then once work was done, I would watch the rest of the series, and it's insane. Like is absolutely crazy, absolutely bonkers, and she's like a huge reason why the show is successful in my mind. I mean, I've never seen like a more like crazy character as her. She's just, I don't even know how to describe it. I mean, she's just bloodlustly in love with Yuki, and
she is like the like, so far that I've known of, she is like the original yandere queen before Ayano Aishi, aka Yandere-chan from Yandere Simulator.
Right.
Like, Yuno was like the OG. Like everything she did was for Yuki, to a point where she would even make herself delusional, even going as far as killing like someone or like killing others so that she could be the only friend like Yuki has. Do you remember that episode? Like,
I do.
Yay. And even kidnaps him at one point.
And I think what I really like about Yuno is how like ruthless, cold, and like she's basically like a very calculating psychopath is the best way to put it.
She is very manipulative, but yet she does it in a very interesting way.
Yeah.
But like with all of her tricks and all the things she can come up with, that is like very impressive for someone that's like 15 or like 14.
Yeah, she's like 14 to 16 in this series. Like, they're basically teens. But like, what I really like about Yuno, and what really makes her carry the series, is like basically like the only thing that matters to her is her and Yuki's survival, and that's the only thing that matters. Like, there's nothing else. Sorry, there's nothing. I'm hitting puberty live on the podcast.
About time.
22, and then like I haven't hit it yet. Like, God, come on, Jaian. And
we were like, lowering expectations, God.
Yeah, I know, right? But like the fact that like the only thing that matters to her is Yuki's survival, and basically this is a survival game, and so she's basically like, I wouldn't say, well, yeah, in a sense, she's carrying Yuki throughout all of this, and like multiple times in the series, she's saying like, "Oh, we'll be the last two standing, and then you can kill me, and you can be the king, Yuki," and that's like the whole message she basically has. I feel like that like element of her is what makes the series so amazing. I mean, if you think of it this way, if Yuno is not insanely like only thinking about the survival of her and Yuki, like the series is not the same.
It wouldn't be the same. That would pretty much destroy at least one of the elements of the plot.
Absolutely. So, who's your favorite character in the entire series?
Oh my gosh. God. Like, my favorite character? Obviously not Yuki.
I wonder why.
Just because I am known as Yuki. Okay, obviously not Yuki. Just because I'm known as Yuki doesn't mean that my favorite character is at Yuki.
Right.
Uryu. Minene.
Right.
Here's the funny thing. I have a huge love for tsundere's. However, Minene's case, she's a terrorist. I'm pretty sure that, like, right now she doesn't even believe in God. There's no God. She creates, like, bombs and stuff like that. Even when she appears in, like, when she first appears, I believe.
In the bombing of the school?
Yeah, the bombing of the school. Like, it's rather captivating to see, like, how, like, what she, like, what she can do with that. And how, like, in that brief fight between her and, spoiler. Especially when she later, after the whole thing, she eventually gained some of Deuce's powers.
Uh-huh.
Making her kind of, like, superhuman, kind of like semi-god, but not exactly a god.
Like a quarter god, maybe.
Quarter god, like, because of how much power she has after it's revealed that Yuno was actually god in the first world.
Yeah, that was a whole twist I want to talk
about. Okay, and spoiler. but, like, her entire character is very interesting. Like, up until that point, I never really encountered a character that didn't exactly, was a terrorist. So, like, seeing her character and, like, the purpose as of why, it is so very interesting to actually meet a character like that and how much she can actually grow as a character from then to the very end.
Right. I agree with that. I absolutely agree with that. Two things on her that I want to talk about. The way she gets her eye taken out with a dart. Oh my God. That scene, like, and so, it's very early in Future Diary. That whole thing was so crazily intense, and I absolutely, like, love that. Like, I kind of felt bad that she lost an eye, and then she was wearing the eye patch and all that. But, like, once she gets her eye taken out, I feel like, you know, we'll never hear about her again. But she gets her eye taken out, and it's, like, it's a really intense scene. But, like, one thing I felt with this character in particular, I feel like she came back too much. Like, she was, like I get it. Like, she's a really good character, but, like, you know, she comes back. She's trying to take out Yuki at some point, and then, like, she becomes, like, a quarter god or whatever you want to call it. You know, I feel like I get it. Like, she leaves and comes back too often. Like, how do you feel about that?
Well, the thing is that there's a point where when everybody assumed that she was dead.
Yeah, exactly. And then she comes back.
That was because you saved her. So that, and gives her the power, like, a bit of his power, so could be put to a stop with all this cycle, I believe. She even made a promise to the cop that was also a diary holder.
Right, I think he was fourth, if I'm not mistaken. I might be wrong.
He had Minene make a promise to, I think, to watch over her, like, his son.
Right.
You know, Yuki, Murumuru, and Minene, they all went to go to the past, like, I believe 2 years prior, correct?
I'm pretty sure it was 2 years past, yeah.
Yeah, 2 years prior, and she goes to make a phone call to Third World, like, the Third World version of the cop, and she actually tells him about the heart condition that his son had.
Uh-huh.
Man, it hung up like right after, like right when he asked Minene who it was, or who it was that he was talking with.
Right.
And that eventually led to, like, the epilogue where, like, his son was fine.
Yeah, and I remember that. And I mean, that was a very touching moment in the anime for me. And like, she, you know, she starts out as this villain, obviously, and I kind of feel like she basically, throughout the series, as she leaves and comes back, every time she comes back as more of a hero and becomes more of a protagonist in the story, more of a good character.
I would say that she's more of an anti-hero, if you think about it.
Yeah, you know, I would agree with that, actually. I would agree more with that. She's more of an anti-hero. She basically takes more of a hero role throughout the series, and that's a really cool thing, and I really did enjoy that. I just felt like her coming back and leaving was, like, and I got kind of competitive in a way. I was like, oh, she's coming back again. Oh, she's gone. Oh, she's coming back again. You know what I mean?
Well, funny thing is that at one point, Deuce's, I'm not even sure if I'm pronouncing the god's name right. I am sorry if I have not. Like, I believe in an OVA, he asked Mirene to take his place as god, and then she declines it, saying that she's happier with the life she has now.
Right.
So that's very interesting to see, like, how she comes from a person that was, like, trying to become god from the survival game to, or maybe she had to in order to survive. I don't know. But, like, she declines it.
Right. No, that's, I think you pretty much got it spot on there. For me, my favorite character is Yuno. I feel like Yuno is the, even though, like, Yuki is the main main protagonist in the story, really, like, he comes out on top and wins the whole game at the end. I feel like you can't have futurity without Yuno. Specifically, like, Yuno has, she carries the series so well, and I feel like she's the staple of the show in the sense that, like, her insanity, her actions, all of her actions dictate how the series go. I was like, if Yuno doesn't act in so murderous, crazy ways, I mean, first of all, you're not taking out all the other competitors. Towards the end of the series, where, like, Yuki gets, like, manipulated by Yuno and, like, starts killing off, like, all of his friends, like, that's, like, I mean, murderously amazing. I'm sorry, but, like, I just really enjoyed it. I was like, this is, like, it's so intense.
That scene made me cry. Akisa Aru was also a favorite of mine.
Oh, yeah.
I cried because he gets beheaded, and I'm just like, you know, you bitch.
Yeah, and, like, the way he...
You're amazing, you know, but you bitch.
Yeah, no, I know what you mean. And she really invokes emotions out of, like, everyone, I feel like. Either you go, like, she's out of her mind, what the hell, or you go, like, I freaking hate you for what you just did. Like, I feel like that's the two main reactions you get to when you do watch her, like, do her thing. And, like, specifically with the beheading of Aru, the way he's like, I gotta let Yuki know that she's won a previous game, and then how he writes it on the cell phone, and then he ends up, like, kissing Yuki, and then, like, she's like, oh, I hate you, and she, like, beheads him, and, like, and all you see is him holding up the cell phone before, like, basically dropping to the floor. Oh my god,
I love that character so
much. Me too. I love that character. That character was gold. Well,
he was gonna be the world's greatest detective.
He really was. I mean, and he really, like,
just like, oh god, why did I think about L from Death Note?
Oh my god. But yeah, you brought something up earlier, and I really want to talk about it, because this is, like, really, like, the meat of the ending of Future Diary. The whole Yuno won the first game twist, and this is her second game, and, like, this is, like, that whole twist, like, how did you react when you found out about it? What are your thoughts?
I was very confused. I was like,
right?
Two Yunos? What? Like, what? Like, how are there two Yunos? Is there, like, a Vegas? Is the other one around? But now that I know VI clips, and, like, I actually bought the episode, like, on my phone on iTunes, and I actually watched, like, exactly what happened. I was actually in tears because, like, Second World Yuno is just, she didn't do it. Well, technically she did kill her parents at that point, but, like, she was still, like, not really, you know, it's just exactly insane. She was kind of mentally.
Not all there.
But she wasn't all there, like, First World Yuno. And, like, when she wrote the message to Yuki, I was just, like, crying, because those are the last words of the original bride of the Yuki we know.
Right, right.
Once it got through to me, like, exactly what happened and, like, what they meant by two Yunos, I was just like, oh,
I completely see where you're coming from.
It's just, like, so intense. And then, like, there was, like, at the end of the episode where, like, it's just Yuno, like, First World Yuno's stare after Yuki finds out about everything.
Uh-huh.
I was just like, you know what you've done.
No, I completely agree. Like, for me, like, that whole twist was so, like, it really flipped the anime upside down. And really, like you're watching the show and you're, like, going, oh, this series is taking such a cool turn. And this is, like, really enjoyable right now. I'm really...
The plot twist is really good. Like, the fact that it's just, like, it's not just, like, oh, it's a survival game and two people have to make it through. No, it's not just that. It's the fact that, like, the person that was also involved was also a person that won the previous game and is playing it again so that the one she loves wins and succeeds becoming God and making sure he doesn't die.
Right, right.
To think it was her that was, it took place in a different world than the first. It was the second world, and that was also shocking.
Yeah, and it really, like, takes the whole anime on a brand new turn, and a very, very exciting one, and one I don't, like, we don't see really often in anime. I don't, there's not many animes that do this kind of flip, and, like, it really intensifies everything, and it really did, and it was pulled off so well. I really enjoyed the whole, you know, this is her second time playing twist. It was really, really good. I wanted to ask you about how did you feel about the death of Yuki's parents? How did that, like, get to you?
Traumatized. The poor boy was traumatized. Is that, like, freaking, like, the mom didn't even do anything, and, like, the dad was the one that killed the mom, right?
Yes, I think. I'm pretty sure.
And right when, like, the dad finally owns up to it and just, like, even, like, decides to turn himself in for killing his own wife, he dies.
Right.
Got by who, though? Do you know?
No, it's not ringing a bell to me right now.
It was just, like, really intense. Like, both, like, he has to know that, like, both of his parents dying, and then seeing both his parents, like, in, like, the third world. I think it was a delusion or something.
Yeah. In that white space.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was, like, a dream, and he was, like, basically, like, living in this dream, and then, like, the ceiling gets cracked, and then they come, and they're like, come with us, Yuki.
Yeah, it's just like, oh, God. But I'm very happy at least that Yuki's parents in, like, the third world are alive.
Right. It's nice to know. It's kind of, like, in a sense, and it's, like, this connection is, like, it's slim, but it kind of does it. It's kind of like this Dragon Ball Z thing where, like, people die, they come back, you know, like, they exist in another world.
But it's not like Dragon Ball Z, because everyone that dies actually comes back to their own world, where there is future diary, where characters stay dead, but in one world where there is another world where they exist until no more, and then there's another world where everyone's alive too, even though their other selves from the other worlds are dead.
Right. Well, I guess, yeah, the comparison wasn't really that good. I was just basically thinking it because, like, you know, they exist, they still exist, they don't exist. It was, it's kind of like a thing where they come, they're there, they're not there. That's kind of what I was trying to
say. I want to say really quick is that, like, the only good comparison, like, the one comparison I could make, like, involving Future Diary is Danganronpa. I am a huge fan of Danganronpa, and, like, the killing, like, their survival killing game thing is kind of similar, I guess. I don't know. Well, not exactly very similar, but just, like, kind of similar. Not, like, hugely, but there. Because I would have to say people will have to find out, like, if they do know about Danganronpa and what happens in Danganronpa, then they know. But if those who do not know Danganronpa, if you really want to, you can just go, like, check out Danganronpa, and you might see what I mean.
Right. Actually, in anime, that you just made me think of, we're talking about comparisons, an anime that really resembles Future Diary a lot. I don't know if you watched. Have you ever watched Higashi no Eden?
I don't know. It sounds familiar.
It's basically like the principle of the game. It's another game with cell phones. Like that. It's really like there's like a select number of users, and they all have cell phones, and they have a certain amount of money in the right. And this phone can, like, pay stuff for them and everything. And basically, like, it's when you run out of money, you die, and you have to improve the country you live in. And it's like this really complicated, like, plot. And so it resembles Future Diary a little quite a bit, actually. So I wish you just go checking out Once again, Higashi no Eden, if you want to something more like Future Diary and you just finish watching it. It's a really good anime. But like I kind of wanted to talk about a specific character that I really particularly enjoyed. His name was Raisuke Huju. It was the little kid in the Future Diary when he was one of the diary users. And at first, like, I think, like, when I was watching the anime, one thing that, like, I could point out very easily was when I saw, like, characters coming, I was like, oh, that guy's a diary holder for sure. Oh, that guy, that girl's a diary holder for sure. The kid, I could not tell. I didn't know. I couldn't figure it out. And then when we find out he is, I was like, what? He's a diary holder? But he's just a little kid. What?
I don't judge anybody by their appearances.
Right.
I mean, Yuki and Yuna are like at the age of like 14 to 15 or like 16. Like, and while the others are just adults.
Right. But I mean, it's a kid. You know what I mean? Like, it's a kid.
It's a very intelligent child.
Absolutely.
I mean, his parents were like, he looks to his puppets as like freaking parent figures.
Yeah, he really does. And I don't know, the way he tries to take them out with like putting like poison in the tomatoes in the salad, and then like, you know, going like, oh, this tomato feels a little heavier than like when I first like made the salad, and like throws it out. I was like, oh my god, you know, like, you are absolutely like to the detail, like game on, eyes on everything, like on par with every single like thing someone tries to throw at you. Something like as precise as that. And
she doesn't even care that she killed a kid. Like,
well, the kid was trying to kill them, to be fair.
Yeah, I know, but it's just like, it's like that intense. Like,
yeah. Yeah. The only thing that matters to her is her and Yuki's survival. And I mean, that's the magic of Future Diary in a sense. Like, she will do anything to save Yuki. Anything. Anything. Kill whoever you have to. That's the way she, like, works. And it's very enjoyable. Very enjoyable because, like, she just goes on these crazy rampages. And, like, I mean, it keeps the anime really exciting. It really does.
Uh-huh.
Was there another particular character you really enjoyed in Future Diary?
Exactly.
Why is that?
Because he's like he's also one of my anime crushes. I have like a long list, people. if you want me to like have like a whole podcast to myself and just talk about like all the anime characters that I have a crush on or consider husbandos and waifus, then that would be like for like a freaking Valentine's Day podcast.
It could be its own series, Yugi.
God damn. It was just like, it's a day for waifus and husbandos.
It really is.
But yeah, the thing is that he's actually very, like, he's intelligent. He's a rather interesting nihilist. I don't think as well as Yuno, though. We all know that Yuno is a really great nihilist.
Really, really.
He wants to become a world's greatest detective. And so I believe that there was actually a side story, like a manga, dedicated to him, taking Yuki's place while like Muramura accidentally erased Yuno's existence.
Oh, I heard about that.
And so Akisa would have to temporarily be Diary Holder 1. While Muramura takes Yuno's place as Diary Holder 2. It's just very interesting of how, like, even the story changed. If, for example, Tsubaki and... Oh, God. Like, I don't know how to feel about Tsubaki in the freaking manga. Like, my fangirl heart is just, like, cringing a bit. But it's just, like, well, he did something, like, that kind of, like, saved her and, like, improve something, so there we go. He deserved it, I guess.
Right.
But like overall, he did things that helped, and oh my god, even like in the freaking OVA, he had the kid be his apprentice.
Yeah, I remember that.
It was really funny and really cute, and oh my god. And also his dedication to Yuki is very admirable because like other than like he was there. He also loved him. He didn't even care if he was like almost close to death. He had to care. He had to let Yuki know about the truth about Yuno, even if it means like having his like head, like even if he gets beheaded. It made me sad. Mm-hmm. But at least, I'm so happy that he still exists in like the third world. And also like that one scene that charmed me the most is like when he was doing the coin flip thing, like betting with. Hinata, I think, wanted Yuki's diary, and she's the one that controls the dogs, because of her dad.
Right, right, right.
God damn, like, he is such a really good character. I am sorry, it's just, he makes me feel stuff, man. Makes me feel feelings.
All of the feelings.
Yes, all the feelings. What character other than Yuna do you like?
For me, like, what other character other than Yuna that I like? Like I said, I was a really big fan of the kid, but another character that I really liked was Takaho. He was the male in the couple of the Future Diary, the couple that was Future Diary holders. That guy's messed up.
Why is he messed up?
I don't know. I just got creeper vibes from him.
No, here's the thing. He actually makes good points and even points out freaking Yuki's faults. Like,
I don't know. I just got a weird vibe from the guy. I just really did.
He's still nice. I mean, like, here's the thing, though. Just, like, in the freaking anime, it shows that, there was a point where she actually gets raped. And then after he finds out where exactly she was, he kills the men that were doing that to her. And even killed the guy that raped her.
Right.
He even considered killing himself because he wasn't able to protect her. But I prevented him from committing suicide, and they managed to move on from that. And
that's what made me feel like he's messed up. Like don't kill yourself over that. I'm sorry. I know it's like it was a big deal and it was like really dramatic in the anime, but I don't know. I felt like there's a certain like strength to him, but there's also like these like very precise weaknesses that kind of just make him. Like he's a good character and I really enjoy him. But like there's like these flaws and these strengths that he has, and like when you put them together, like it works. But it basically, when I say he's messed up, like he's not the kind of dude I would like to grab a drink with, is what I'm saying. Basically.
I would because he seems like a cool guy.
I don't know.
Rude. Anyways.
Actually, a reason why I really also liked Takaho is the diary that he has. Basically, the diary that he has is the murder diary, and it predicts how and where he can kill his he will kill his victim, and how like to best corner the victim. And it's really, really cool. I just that type of diary is extremely useful in like in a survival game when you think about it, because the whole point of the game is to kill everyone else. So his diary was like probably like the best one to use, and it's like one that's just, you know, made to assassinate your opponents. And like I know this sounds like really cold and intense when I'm saying this, but like I'm just. Put yourself in the character's position. You want that kind of diary when like your life is on the line.
Hmm. Yeah, that is true.
What kind of which diary was your favorite?
If I have to be honest, I would have to say I would have to say the investigation diary.
Right. Can you remind me, investigation diary, what it does and who has
it? It gives you the information about like future crimes and activities committed anywhere.
Oh wow. Okay.
So I would say that diary is like really good to have, because then you would be able to know information about like the crimes and activities before it even happens.
For me, like another diary I really found cool was Kamado's diary. Basically, her diary, the way it's called, if I'm not mistaken, is the blog diary. She basically with this diary can produce a bunch of other diaries, right? And like what's cool about what's cool about that is that she can make her own army, and the people who have these created diaries from her blog diary, what's really cool about that is like if you destroy those created diaries, the user doesn't die because it's not one of the original 12 diaries, and so you can really like build your own army with that diary, which is really cool.
That sounds really cool.
Any other diaries you enjoy?
It may sound kind of weird, but I actually also like the Yukitero diary. Why? My reason for this is because of the fact that it's so interesting how it's created for, like, it's made for Yuno, and it's basically keeping track of everything about Yuki. And with that diary, that brings up the whole other meaning of stalker. It's just like, what the hell?
Another diary I really enjoyed was Tsubaki's diary, like that scroll she has, and like basically how she can like basically, it's another cool thing was like with her followers, thanks to that diary, she can see like the future through her followers' eyes, so she has an even bigger perspective on the entire game. The way these diaries are made, they're also unique.
Oh yeah, she's blind, huh?
Yeah, she is. So that's what's really interesting about her diary. And like, yeah, like those, there's so many different types of diaries. And like, I think another element that like is where on top of only care about Yuki's survival is that all these diaries are super different. They all predict the future in a sense, but they all do so many different things, and it's really, really, really cool. And I think that's what makes it like the survival game even more incredible.
Yeah, I would have to agree so, because, oh my God. What if our friends had, like, what if, like, our friends had a diary of their own? Like, I mean, like...
I don't even want to think about that.
Wow. Party. Let's make a club.
Future Diary DDS Club!
Who was it about? Oh, I'm sorry, but only diary holders can enter.
Oh, we have some audience questions to answer. Let's get into them.
All right.
So, okay, first question is from @A ulti reel, and the question is, what was your favorite part of the anime, and what do you think could have been improved for Future Diary? What was your favorite part, and what do you think could... My favorite part of the entire anime is definitely the Yuno twist, how she's like, this is her second time playing. That was really cool. I really enjoy that twist. I mean, I've already explained why. The way it flips the entire anime is so great, and it's so awesome. What I thought could have been improved was Mirane's, like, the way she came back and left all the time. I felt that was kind of annoying. I mean, she was kind of overused in that sense. I didn't really enjoy that too much, but that's just a nitpick. It's a really good anime, and I really enjoy it. So, yeah, that's what I would say. What about you, Yuki?
My favorite throughout the entire anime was, like, with Tsubaki. If Yuki didn't arrive to where they were, then Yuno will, you know, be gang-raped.
Right.
What I actually wish could have been done with that was, like, and when Yuki came in to save, you know, I was thinking maybe they could have, like, done something more than just, like, Yuki, like, throwing the dart. I think that's really cool, but it, you know what would be more cool? Is the fact that, like, Yuki would have the distraction and Yuno would be the attacker.
Right.
Like, I know she was naked and all that, but, like, what if she literally, like, creates a false attack and then, like, everything the same, but, like, Yuki would just throw up the ball, and then, although it would seem like Yuno would be the attacker, it would also be Yuki that's making the actual attack.
Right.
Like, I don't know, like, I feel that scene would have been a lot better. Like, I know there's a couple scenes that could have been done better, but that's just the one I could think of now.
Don't worry, I'll cut that part out. Next question is from Juicy Fruity @theworstpieever. That's like an amazing handle.
That is great. Whoever that is, congratulations. Good job. I love that.
Yeah, well, we really enjoy it. All right. Are you content with the ending? Did it complete the anime for you, or was it missing a little something? I was very content with the ending. It was a very satisfying ending. You could say that, you know, well, no, yeah, Yuki does win at the end, and the way it all comes together with Yuno and everything, and how he manages to save the third world Yuno and all that stuff, and it all, how it all, like, it basically becomes this happy ending. It was satisfying for me. So yeah. It wasn't missing anything in particular.
I'm also really content with the ending, and especially with the OVA that actually takes place around the ending, like with Yuki and all that. However, there is one thing that I really wanted for, like, the OVA, considering the fact it also connects to the ending.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so there's a moment where, like, third world Yuno goes to, you know, the whole, like, god realm or whatever.
Right.
Yeah, and there's a scene where she meets first world Muramura.
Okay.
Who has all the memories of Yuno, the first world Yuno.
Right.
What I wished they could have done is have, like, a little monologue between the Yuno, like, first world Yuno, even though she's dead, like, maybe, like having a conversation with herself, like, from the Yuno, first world Yuno, from those memories. And seeing if third world Yuno is willing to really take the memories, third world Yuno would accept, and then it would lead to her running to go reunite with Yuki.
Right.
That would have been a lot more interesting, because we all know that, like, first world Yuno kills second world Yuno. So her, like, so third world Yuno having a talk with the first world Yuno made from those memories, that'd actually be really interesting if you think about it.
It really would be. I want that to happen. Make it happen, someone. Someone abridge it or just do something.
May it be made in, like, fan art or something, but that would be really interesting.
I'm sure it could be abridged somehow. I mean, you can ask, like, the TFS guys or something. I don't know.
No.
Make it happen. Listen.
Diane, let me slap you.
You can't. I'm in Canada. You're in the States. It doesn't work like that.
Well, dude, when you come over here, like, someday, I will slap you and I will hit you.
Dude, that doesn't make me want to come over at all.
Yes, it does, because you love us.
Not for a slap.
But then what other rating should I give you? Just, if it's like, it's me, man.
Yeah, no, good point.
Okay. Oh, God.
So that's going to do it for this episode of Anime Podcasters. We got a couple of things I want to hit on before we leave. I want to talk something really cool that's happened to me, and this is anime related, and it's about the channel. So first of all, I put out this cover of the Death Note opening, The World, and it got picked up by this website called comicbook.com. They made an article about it. These guys have 4.7 million likes on their Facebook page, and they posted my cover there. And they gave me some very, very nice comments, and we got a bunch of new subscribers, and that's why we broke 10,000 subscribers on the channel. So I just want to give a huge personal thank you and shout out to comicbook.com on the podcast for that. I really appreciate you guys. I don't know how you found my cover, but I'm very appreciative that you shared it and that you enjoyed it. That's that's beyond amazing.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Yeah, thank you so much. Next episode, I really hope we can get we had this guest in this episode in the works of the last months, and I think she got her microphone. I think we can make this episode happen. I just want to give a warning out there. Next month, for the month of February episode, I'm going to be super busy. So in terms of, like, the podcast is still going to happen, but we're probably just going to be overlaying an image over the audio, because I'm not going to have time to go through, like, an hour of footage and, like, editing pictures and everything, just because I'm going to be, like, doing, like, full-time at a university right now. Just want to let you know about that. The podcast will still happen, and hopefully we'll have our guest on. That would be amazing. I want to give a huge shout out to GoProkyo. Please go check him out at GoProkyo on Twitter. He does amazing artwork. He does all the artwork for Anime Podcasters. This guy needs more followers. He needs more attention. Go give him some love. Tell him Giant Music sent you.
Please.
All right. Oh my God, we at the same time. All right, Yuki, where can people find you on the internet? What do you want to plug?
Jinx. Anyways, you can find me at MiraculousXYuki on Twitter. I'm also known as MiraculousXMelody up on YouTube. Yeah, that's where you'll find. For Twitter, I might also add in, like, some of my artwork up there. I know I'm working on an artwork right now, like a banner, so for my channel. So I don't know. I'll probably get it done by this month. Sometime this month. I'm going to be pretty busy due to school and stuff like that, so.
Yeah. Completely understand. Anything else?
And my New Year's resolution, actually, for this year is to be able to work on covers and stuff like that for my channel.
Right. I can help you out with
that. So that's going to be pretty exciting.
Right. That's awesome. On my side of things, I am putting out a bunch of new content that I've recorded over the holidays. I'm rebooting a series called the JaianMusic Q&A series. Every second Wednesday, starting in February, I'll have 10 episodes in total. They're going to be coming out every 2 weeks. So subscribe for that. Also, I have a bunch of covers that I worked on. I even finished a Tokyo Ghoul cover, like, just before the podcast, and I showed Yuki. Yuki, how was it sounding?
I cried.
That's a good thing, guys.
Dude, guys, I cried because you don't understand. I'm a fan of Tokyo Ghoul, and I'm just like and crying because feelings. I should not have feelings.
So yeah,
my heart should be cold as ice. Damn it.
Like Yuri on Ice.
I love that show. Don't you dare bring this into it.
We're gonna be off for another hour. All right. So yeah, guys, subscribe to my channel. My Twitter is at JaianMusic. I'm doing a bunch of stuff. I'm doing a bunch of content. So make sure to follow me on all my social media. That's gonna be it. I think we basically covered everything. Yeah. All right, guys. Thank you so much for checking out this episode. Make sure to subscribe to not miss the next one. And
and also give me a tweet saying that like I am a freaking savage.
Go tweet at Miraculous X Yuki and tell her she's a do it.
And also, and please like burn Diane. I know I do, and it's fun.
Burn me in the comments of the video. Just let me know. Like, just like post like fire emoticons.
Burn.
All right. Bye, guys.
Bye.